So we continue with the next presentation. Our next speaker is Fabian Reinhardt, and he's talking about Prometheus.
I'm Fabian, and I work at SoundCloud as a production engineer. And today I will give you a general introduction into Prometheus, and hopefully get into it some advanced topics. And at the end, I will do a brief demo. Yeah. So to understand why we built Prometheus, we first have to look back and see what SoundCloud looked like in 2012 when Prometheus was started. So back then, we had, as most startups, a monolithic Ruby on Rails app handling all our domain logic, and it had one public API, and all our services and applications were talking to this public API. The whole thing was backed by a MySQL cluster and, of course, some memcached instances. But as we scaled, of course, this did no longer work. So we had to shift towards a microservice model. And to this day, we have this Ruby on Rails app around. We call it the mothership. And we started dragging out certain functionality into our microservices. And they are talking to the mothership via an internal API. So monitoring essentially looked like we have many services, and they are all pushing their metrics to StatsD and from there to Graphite. And then we have, of course, service monitoring in Graphite, looks about like this. Then we, of course, have host monitoring via Ganglia and Nagios. And none of these are particularly pretty and easy to use, at least not for the developers who are not constantly concerned with operations. So we wanted to something different, and the Graphite setup did just no longer scale, because all the services were exposing way more metrics than the mothership did originally. And an initial thought was to just have more Graphite setups, like per team, but Graphite is not the easiest thing to run. And so back then, Matt Proud and Julius Foltz joined SoundCloud, and they came from Google, and they had their own idea how monitoring should look like. So they started playing with some ideas how monitoring could be implemented differently in the open source world. And so they made their first commit to the Prometheus project in late 2012, so about 3 years ago. And the public announcement was this January. But it has always been open source on GitHub, but nobody actually knew about it, because we're not announcing it in any way. So if you have followed some tech news, you might have read the Borg paper by Google that came out a few months ago, or early this year, I guess. And accompanied by Borg is BorgMon, and there were some talks by Google SREs about BorgMon. And you will find some ideas from BorgMon are reappearing in Prometheus, but at the same time, Prometheus is doing quite a few things differently, just because it's an open source project and has to work well with way more different setups. So to walk through the core features of Prometheus, the most fundamental part is by far the multi-dimensional data model. So from other systems, you might be used so that you have dimensions, like the HTTP status code that was returned and such, but they're usually structured in some sort of tree. So you can access them only in the way that this tree defines them. And Prometheus does this differently. So all dimensions are at an equal level. And as an example here, we have a metric that gives us the total count of HTTP requests made to a service. And of course, this HTTP requests have different dimensions. So we have a path that was requested, you have a return status code, and you have a method. And of course, if your service is running on multiple nodes, you have an instance for each of those counters. In total, unfortunately, this results in all your metrics times all their labels and times all those values those labels can have. So you can have, for a single service, potentially millions of different time series. And having millions of time series, and if you're querying them, maybe thousands or tens of thousands, you cannot make sense of those. So you need a powerful query language that allows you to access all these dimensions in a meaningful way and basically aggregate the data in a way that you can understand what's going on. So Prometheus comes with a query language that supports exactly that. So here, for example, we have our HTTP request total counter. And now we only want those counters that are considering the status codes 500-something, so the errors. And now this is a counter, so this always goes up and up and up. And looking at the graph, that doesn't make much sense. So we want a rate. So you can provide a time window, 5 minutes in this case, and build a rate. And this will always return you a per second value. So now we have, for all our 500 status codes, the rate per second. But we still have all these other dimensions in there, so like parse, method. And this might still be hundreds or thousands of time series. So we have to aggregate. So we do a sum, and we want to preserve some dimensionality. So we just don't want one number at the end, but we want certain numbers for pairs of parse and method. So we do exactly that. And now we might be only interested in the worst offenders. So one service is misbehaving on certain parse method combinations. So we do a top K, and we get the three most erroring endpoints and their method. Similarly, Prometheus supports server-side histograms. So if you're calculating quantiles at the client side or at your service and expose those, you might have 599 percentiles, but you can now not aggregate over them. You can get a max and a min, but you can't do an average. You can, but the mathematical result is wrong. So Prometheus supports server-side histograms, for example, and with our query language, you can now calculate any arbitrary percentile. So to understand, Prometheus expressions essentially always return a vector. So you always have entries, and those entries are always a label set and one value associated with each label set. So it's always, Prometheus is by definition always some sort of multidimensional. Another feature that's very important is, in contrast, for example, to graphite, that Prometheus is easy to use and easy to deploy, and at the same time still scalable. So it's a single static binary with no dependencies at all. So essentially, you can just copy it onto your server and run it, and it's all good. And actually, it's written in Go, so building it is also very easy. If you run go-get and provide the GitHub path, it will download the source code, build it for you, and install it, and then you can just run the binary. Then there, of course, are also runtime dependencies. So Prometheus does not rely on any remote storage. So we don't use OpenTCP and such, but we have our own local storage. So we can start right away. And this local storage is quite efficient. So we have a high throughput rate. We can constantly ingest about 380,000 samples per second. But that's the max. And we have an efficient compression mechanism. So per sample, we need about 4.5 bytes. The optimum would probably be more around 1.4, but this is, for example, if you're gzipping the content, but with our compression, we have random access, which is important for querying. Yeah, so here we see the basic architecture of Prometheus. This looks quite bright. Can you see that? So in the middle is the Prometheus server, which is running on a single node. And it's basically divided into three layers. So we have the retrieval layer, which is only concerned with figuring out which targets you want to monitor, and then getting out and scraping those metrics from those targets, and then hands down all those samples to the storage layer. And the storage layer then cares about persisting this data onto your hard drive and also handling caching. So if you have dashboards, they are constantly accessing the same data. So you want to keep this around in memory and don't always read this from disk because you're reading it every few seconds. And then to get this data back out again, we have our PromQL querying layer, which is essentially the query language I've shown you before. And the whole thing, of course, comes with an API. So our web UI and different dashboarding solutions can query this API and get the data out again. And then alerting also happens within Prometheus, at least partially. So you can provide the alerting rules, and Prometheus will constantly evaluate those alerting rules. And as soon as an alert is considered firing, it will send out those alerts to the alert manager. And the alert manager then cares about making sense of those alerts, which might come in at a high frequency, and dispatching them correctly to your pager duty or Slack channel or email. There are about like 10 or 12 integrations. We also have a push gateway. So if you have batch jobs, those might be gone by the time Prometheus comes around to pull the metrics. So you can push those metrics to push gateway, and it will keep them until Prometheus is ready to scrape them. We can also talk to other Prometheus servers, but that's a different chapter. We will look into that later. And just to provide a slide with all the fancy logos, these are different products or companies and such we integrate with. So we have different integration points. We have service discovery, And we have, of course, client libraries. So we have four natively official ones and about four or five unofficial ones, and there are more being worked on. There are also some products out there that are already exporting Prometheus metrics natively, for example, etcd or Kubernetes, and I think there's one more, CAdvisor, for example. So if you're running those, they already provide you with Prometheus metrics and are ready to scrape. For other things like MySQL, there are products that have been around for a long time and they will be around for a long time, but there's essentially zero chance that they will ever expose Prometheus metrics. And for those, we have so-called exporters. So those are essentially small binaries that are just reading stats from those programs in the form that they're provided and then just expose them in a Prometheus readable way. Yeah. Ah, yeah, and of course, we have different support for basically reading or writing your data out to other storage engines like OpenTSDB, InfluxDB, and most recently Graphite. So our local storage is, of course, limited. So we have a retention time. After maybe like 4 weeks or 2 months or something, your data will be just cut off at the end. But if you want long-term storage, you can stream the data out to another solution. So native instrumentation is also quite easy. Here we have the most complex form, which is the server-side histogram. We define a histogram with a metric name, HTTP request duration seconds. And this histogram is, of course, supposed to store the time a request took. And the namespace is usually just your application name. And then you provide a small description and the buckets of your histogram. And then you can just use it. So if you have an API handler, you just record the start time. And before returning, you just calculate the difference, so the total time this request took, and make an observation to the histogram along with the labels we have specified for this histogram. So in this case, the path label, the method label, and the status label. And then basically we need one more line of code. So the client library comes with a handler function, and you just have to register this handler function for your listener. So then that you actually expose this metrics endpoint that serves the metrics Prometheus can read. Yeah, there are different visualizations. So we have a web UI where you can do all sorts of querying. That's where you usually go if you got paged or encountered a problem in the dashboard. Then you go to the Prometheus UI and now can query and drill down into the problem and figure out what's wrong. And there you can access, you can show graphs or you can access the raw values. Also, since about 4 weeks, I think, we natively are supported by Grafana, which is fantastic. When Prometheus was started, Grafana was not around yet. So back then, we built our own custom dashboarding solution, PromDash. It works quite well, but if you get started nowadays, I would highly recommend using Grafana. It's just way better and, has way more features. So going back to this diagram, here we see our server again, and we see we have just one local HDD or SSD. And the question is, how does this even scale? So at SoundCloud, we are using functional sharding, essentially. So we have Prometheus servers for different services or for different teams. So most metrics, you never need to correlate at all. There are services that have no relation to each other, so there's no value in having the metrics at the same on the same hard drive. But there are also bigger customers or users of Prometheus out there. For example, DigitalOcean. So you might know them. They are quite a large cloud provider. And they have their so-called droplets. And they have many, many, many of them. And they cannot store them on a single Prometheus server or the metrics of them. So there are various ways to scale with Prometheus. We have a federation and a sharding mechanism. Federation just being a protocol for Prometheus servers to grab metrics from other Prometheus servers, and sharding is a quite simple configuration which allows you to just select a subset of targets for a certain job. So suppose we have three clusters. We can now have one Prometheus server that's scraping the container metrics in each cluster. So it scrapes all your CAdvisors. And now you want, of course, to have a global view of what's going on in all your clusters. So we can have global Prometheus server handling container metrics. And now you can federate some aggregated view of your metrics up to the server. So you can now build a global dashboard showing you all the global view. And if you then see a problem, you can drill down into a per cluster instance of Prometheus and figure out what's going on. And you can do the same with services. So this is pretty much the same setup, except for that in cluster C, we have two Prometheus servers. And that's because in this cluster, apparently, one server of Prometheus is not enough to handle all the instances of a service we have running. So we just do the simple sharding. Each Prometheus server scrapes 50% of the total targets, and so the data is separated onto two different servers, and they both federate their data up to the global service metrics server. And with that, you can pretty much scale as far as you like. Another big part is service discovery. So Prometheus is a pull-based monitoring system, which makes things easier for your client applications because they don't have to care about where to push their metrics and when to push their metrics. They just provide this endpoint and serve their data whenever someone wants it. It's also easier for development, so you can just spin up a local Prometheus server on your machine and just start scraping random targets. And of course, it makes it easier to have an HA setup. So HA in Prometheus simply means running two of them with the same configuration. And so now it's the servers don't have to care about pushing their metrics to two different servers and such. But you have to know which targets you want to monitor. And that's where service discovery comes in. And in a modern infrastructure, you luckily have service discovery in any reasonably sized infrastructure. And the most simple one is probably DNS as a records, and probably also the most common one. It essentially means you have a record name, and associated with the record name, you have a set of host names, and for each host name, you have a port. And each combination of port and host name basically is one target serving a certain service. And now we can simply configure Prometheus. Let's say we want to scrape our foo API service, and this foo API service exposes all its metrics at the metrics endpoint. And now we just configure our DNS as a record, and it's set refresh interval. And so every 10 seconds, Prometheus will do a DNS query and get all the targets, and then start or stop monitoring them as required. But there are more fancy SDs out there, at least by now. So for example, you have Console, which handles cluster membership and service discovery. We have cluster scheduling like Marathon, which on the top of Mesos, or Kubernetes. There's EC2, so you can request via the AWS API all your EC2 instances. You might have Finagle server sets in ZooKeeper, and they are different things. And all those top five are supported natively by Prometheus. And if you have your own or any that's not supported, we have a file-based plug-in mechanism. So you just write a small binary that just frequently writes down all the targets that are currently belonging to your service, and then Prometheus will just watch this file and get the targets from there. One big challenge in implementing the service discovery in Prometheus was, how do you keep this generic? So they all have different APIs, and even within a single mechanism, you can handle it differently for your organization. And we somehow have to stay in generic without restricting anyone. And that's essentially when we came up with relabeling. So this is a bit of detailed. In Prometheus, each target is associated by a label set, so a set of key value pairs. And there are some magic labels out there, for example, the address label. So the address label always identifies the host and port under which a target is reachable. And then you can just have more labels. For example, if an instance is in cluster AB and belongs to the production environment, you can have those labels attached to this target. And they will also be attached to every metric we get from this target. So you can later on slice and dice your metrics along those dimensions as well. And in this example, we have quite a unique setup. We might have a service that has a service port and a telemetry port. And this might be just unique to your organization. And now Prometheus should go to the telemetry port and not talk to the service port. And now we can define a relabeling configuration, which is quite verbose, but flexible. So we can take source labels. In this case, we care about the address label and the telemetry port label. And then we get a concatenation of the values of those labels. And we can then apply regex to that. And based on that regex, we can define a replacement. So now we take the IP and the telemetry port and write into the address label the new combination of original IP address and telemetry port. And as a result, we now get the target we actually want. So the address label is now using the telemetry port, and our target is essentially ready to go. And there are different actions for those relabeling configurations, and you can chain them. So this can get quite complex, but usually you do this once for your infrastructure, and then never touch it again. As an example, we can do this for AWS. So here we have an EC2 configuration, and we define a region, a refresh interval, how often we want to update our targets, and a port. These are just the minimum requirements. And this will make Prometheus go out to the API and get all your EC2 instances. And you get them all with the address label set. And then you get those extra meta labels, which are unique to this type of service discovery. So you have the instance ID label, the public IP label, and the private IP label. And for each tag you have defined in your AWS, you also get a label associated with this tag. And all the labels starting with 2 underscores are essentially filtered out before your actual target is generated, so those won't be attached to your time series. And now we can use relabeling. We have all those targets with the address label and those meta labels, and we can use relabeling to basically get the meaningful targets we actually want. So there is now another relabeling configuration using the keep action. And we take, let's say we have encoded our service type in the tag type in AWS. And now we only want to keep those targets where the type matches the regex foo API, and all other targets are dropped. In the next step, we want to get our deployment label to be attached to our time series. So we take the deployment tag from our meta label and just write it into the regular deployment label. And now we have all our targets belong to the foo API, and all time series will have the respective value for the deployment label attached. So this basically closes the Prometheus part. Prometheus is more of an ecosystem, so we also cover alerting, or at least we are about to cover alerting fully. And the alert manager is another part, and it essentially acts completely independent from Prometheus. In general, we of course have a lot of opinions on alerting, but we don't want to impose those opinions on you. So a classic example would be thresholds. So of course, you often have a critical threshold and a warning threshold, but sometimes you have 3 or 4 thresholds, sometimes you have none. So this is something we don't bake into alerting. And also alerting is directly defined on Prometheus' time series data, which is really helpful because now you can consider data over time and not just single data points. In general, you do alerting in Prometheus, so you define the alerting rules, but you handle alerts in the alert manager. So you can be very verbose on firing in Prometheus to preserve all this information you need. But you want to have compact and detailed notifications. So if half of your cluster is going down, you don't want to get a page for each node in your cluster. But you want to get one page telling you, OK, 50% of your nodes are down. But in the end, then you want to see which ones are down. So this is the part that's handled in Prometheus. You define alerting rules. So we just give it a name, high error rate. And now using the Prometheus query language, we can just define an expression. And in this case, the expression gives us the percentage of failing requests per second for right now. And we just multiply this by 100. And this alert is considered firing if the percentage of failing requests is above 1%. But this is only true if this condition is true for more than 10 minutes. So if you have a small blip at 4 a.m. at night, you don't have to page someone, because if it is gone by the time someone wakes up and checks it, there's nothing to do, and also no reason to wake someone up. Then you can define a summary, so just giving a small description. And then you can actually use the labels resulting from your expression to populate a description and give meaningful details. And as we've seen before, expressions in Prometheus return vectors, not single values. So this alert might actually return something like this. And each row or each entry in our vector is a single alert. So one alerting rule can potentially generate many, many alerts. So we get an alert for each method pass combination that is above this error threshold. And then the question is, how can we implement something like critical and warning thresholds if we don't have it baked in? this could look something like this. So we just define the alert twice. This is, of course, more verbose. But we can define it with different error thresholds. So we consider it critical if it's above 3% and warning if it's above 1%. And using the with keyword, we can then attach additional labels to the label set that is pushed out as one alert. So for all alerts generated by the first rule, we attach the severity equals warning label. And for the second rule, we attach the severity equals critical label. So then the question is, if my alert is critical, it's also at the warning stage. So I get it twice. And that's where the alert manager comes in. So current state of the alert manager is that it's a proof of concept implementation. And over the past few weeks, we have been rewriting it and are implementing now all this, those additional features we would like to have. And this sort of represents a state where we are now in an alpha version and will hopefully be in a stable version within a few weeks. So suppose now Prometheus sends hundreds of alerts into the alert manager. And then you go through a filtering stage. So first is inhibition. You can think of inhibition as a way to define rules to automatically silence certain alerts. So if an alert is already firing at a critical level, we silence all the alerts that have the same alert name and are concerned with the same instance or the same labels that are firing at the warning level. Then there's, of course, manual silencing, which also is based on those labels. So you can silence a whole cluster, you can silence a particular server in a cluster. You can basically use all dimensions you have. And after that, we are entering a routing tree. So that's a tree you configure. And based on labels, you can now decide where which alert is routed and who receives it. You can also define grouping. So you might group all alert names, all alerts that have the same name in the same cluster. But you might apply different schemes at different level in your at different levels in your tree. And a classic example would be to have one node per team, and each team can then decide for their respective subtree how alerts will be handled. And at the very end, essentially, we just send out the alerts or in a batched way to all our integrations. So to give another example of alerting with Prometheus. A quite frequent use case is a disk full alert. And the classical way to do this would be have a threshold of like 90%. And if your disk is full, 90% and a bit more, then you get paged. So now, if you have a server that has been at 89.9% disk full for the last 3 years, you add now a single file, and suddenly everything is apparently not OK anymore. Even though actually everything is pretty OK, and you can't do anything about it, except for delete a file to make the alert stop. So that's where Prometheus provides a better approach. For example, we have a node exporter that exports many different system-level statistics. For example, also how many free space is on a particular device. And we can now just consider the free bytes over the last hour and do a linear prediction. And we extrapolate the basically our data for the next 4 hours. And if in the next 4 hours, at our current rate of growth, we are running out of space, then we page you. Because then we have quite high confidence that you are actually going to have to do something. And again, we only do this if this condition holds true for more than 5 minutes. So if you have a small growth that then stops again, there's no point either. And again, we can populate the description with all those meaningful labels like device name, mount point, and host name. Yeah, and with that, we already reached our demo. So I wanted to show you how to spin up a Kubernetes cluster and deploy an instrumented service, and then start monitoring it with Prometheus within 3 minutes. But apparently, the Wi-Fi does not allow for that. So I made something simpler, but I hope it works as well. So I have configured a Prometheus server with some static targets running on my machine. And here we see a simple configuration. So I have the same service running 6 times, or supposedly running 6 times, on my machine on different ports. And I'm scraping it every 3 seconds. And now here I see all my targets. And apparently one is down. This is because it didn't start in the first place. But this shows that because you have service discovery or you're pulling in general, you can detect if an instance that's supposed to be up is not up. with pushing, that's not really possible. So all those targets are exposing metrics at the metrics endpoint, and this looks something like this here. So this is about 300 metrics, and this is a text format. So we have a protocol buffer format for basically inter-machine communication, and a more simple text format if you are basically just hacking away or want to check the metrics with your browser. And it's really simple. So we have our metrics, as you've seen on the slides. We have a metric name and the labels and the values. And then we just have, at the end, basically a floating point value representing the current value of this time series. And our Prometheus goes out every 3 seconds and just gets all this data and ingests it. So now you see this is all pretty raw and seems quite useless, maybe. But we are basically ingesting everything we can. And as high a dimensionality as possible as we can. And now if we want to access those metrics, we can go into our expression browser in the UI. And for example, the service is not really instrumented well. It just exposes 4 metrics. But we can check how many requests are in progress right now. And we get this for each instance of our service. And then we can graph that. And here is where my laptop was closed. And these are just graphs that are not telling us much, right? It's kind of a mess. The only interesting thing about this metric is probably what's the total number of requests in progress over time, which looks something like that. A more interesting metric is, for example, our histogram, which is measuring the duration of a request. So all those service instances are getting fake traffic, and we are exposing a histogram. And this histogram also basically just counts the number of requests, which is quite helpful. And so here we see way more metrics or time series. That's because for each instance, we have all possible method, API, method pass, and status combinations. And if we graph those, it doesn't work. We get quite a mess, just many overlapping lines and a high number of time series in general, and we can't really do anything with that. So what we also, those are just counters, so as they always go up, and it's hard to identify what's going on. So the first step would be to build a rate, for example. And the rate tells us a per second value for each instance and method and pass combination. And we still have way too many lines to make sense of it, so we do an aggregation. So if we just want to get our rates by pass, this already makes more sense. So now we can say, okay, we have 3 lines, and I can see which pass is getting which, how much traffic. And if I want to know more detail, I can just add another dimension, like the method. And now I can figure out, okay, our GET requests are way more frequent than our POST requests. Another example I've shown before are histograms. So histograms are exposed as buckets. Essentially, a histogram consists of many multiple different time series. And each bucket of our histogram is a distinct time series. And the bucket size is encoded in this LE, which means lower equal value label. And here we get way, way more time series. And now we can use the histogram quantile function to actually generate a meaningful histogram or a meaningful percentile from them. So as a first step, we have to build a rate for each bucket. And then we want to sum these by the bucket size, essentially, because the histogram quantile function needs a bucket label to calculate the actual quantile. And now we have a histogram of our latency for all our services. And this is an actual correct percentile across different servers. But of course, now we have a total request duration, and this is not really helpful. So again, we can add in dimensions as we like. So if you again want to know them by pass, we can now see the 99th percentile of request duration by pass. And those spikes you're seeing are basically really badly generated fake traffic.
Can you do thresholds?
How do you mean?
Could I trigger a threshold on one of these graphs?
How do you mean trigger? You mean like an alerting, for example? Yeah, exactly. So we can just do a comparison. So, and this will just filter out all entries in the vector that are not matching it. And in our relatively buggy web UI, this does not look too great. So thresholds are just filtering out all data points that are not matching the threshold. You won't see the line, right? So that's something you would do in your dashboarding. So we just are now filtering out all the data points and they are now just missing. So, but for alerting with this thresholding, you would basically filter out all alerts that are not matching your threshold. There are actually about, I think we have a few dozen query functions, predict linear being one of them, various derivatives, histogram quantiles, aggregating, and rate are probably the most frequent ones, but they're all listed on our website. Yeah, and that's basically the Prometheus part. And what would now usually happen is that you have configured alerting rules in your Prometheus server. You would see those here, and Prometheus would constantly evaluate those, and as they are firing, would send them out to Alert Manager. To make this step a bit simpler, I would just immediately talk to the Alert Manager API. So here we have our Alert Manager, which is the new development version. And the API is fairly simple. So does this work? So essentially, alerts sent to Alert Manager in a very simple way. We have a set of labels, which are identifying an alert. And then you have annotations. Those are not identifying, they are just additional information. And are basically just overwritten if you submit the same alert twice. And Alert Manager does deduplication based on the labels. So here we have just a bunch of different alerts we are now sending to the Alert Manager. And as Prometheus would do, we can just do this multiple times. And Alert Manager will detect the duplicates and handle them respectively. So the Alert Manager configuration is a bit more verbose than the Prometheus one. For example, here we are defining a routing tree, and we're defining grouping options and certain timing options that are valid for the whole subtree. And here we configure, for example, based on the service label, if the service is Bazooka or AHA proxy, I would send an email to prod.eng email. If there's also a severity critical label, I will send it to the pager. And then we have this different configuration for different teams. And here we have an example of an inhibition rule. So this is a very generic rule. You define this once at the top, and this will basically handle all your critical and warning inhibition. So we don't get a warning notification for critical alerts. And now here, we can see all our alerts. And there can be hundreds of them because you might have 20 different teams and they all get alerted. So let's say I got a page. I can just select my prod.eng pager because I know I'm using the prod.eng pager. And now I will see all the alerts that were sent to the prod.eng pager. And this basically, I will get one alert for this whole group. So yeah, Wi-Fi. So usually you get this alert within like 3 seconds, and you get one alert telling you, okay, you have an alert, many open connections in cluster DD for the service Bazooka, and there are 3 occurrences of this alert. And then you can go into the UI and check each individual occurrence. So here 3 different instances are affected. And then you can just expand those alerts and check the details. So for example, on this node, my number of open connections is apparently 2,344. And usually Prometheus sends you an URL, which leads you back to the respective Prometheus server, so you immediately see a graph of the expression that caused the alert. And then you can apply stuff like silencing. So you silence based on labels. So this, you just get by default all the labels for this alert. So there it is. Now you can just add or remove labels. For example, I want to mute this alert for this whole cluster. Yeah, so good. So I want to mute the many open connections alert for the cluster DD, and for the next 4 hours, and then I create this alert, and now I won't get paged anymore. and I can check my silences here, and also edit and delete them, yeah, and get some additional information. And that's essentially how Alert Manager works, or at least the stable version will work in a few weeks, and that's our approach to alerting in combination with Prometheus. And that's the end. Thanks.
So we have about 20 minutes left for questions at this moment. No questions? Really? Oh, here's one.
What are you using for long-time data storage for the metrics?
So that's basically where our integrations with OpenTSDB, Graphite, and InfluxDB kick in. Currently, if you have a large enough server, we have some servers that are storing data for 6 months. But yeah, of course, if you want real long-time storage, that's something we want to figure out in the end, eventually. But for now, our biggest concern is having local storage that allows you to access your data when your infrastructure is down and you don't have access to your distributed OpenTSDB.
Thanks.
Okay, another one.
Will the Alert Manager only work with Prometheus, or is there API kind of thing?
Apparently I didn't show this correctly. So here I was generating alerts manually, essentially. So we have an API, and Alert Manager and Prometheus are essentially completely decoupled. There's no real point that requires you to use alerts with Prometheus. You can send in anything you like. And we see this quite good here. Prometheus sends an alert like this. So if it evaluates an expression, it has the labels for an alert. But the value of the expression is in the annotations, because it's not something that everything that wants to alert has. So a value is not something that belongs to an alert necessarily. So as long as you have a set of labels and annotations, which can be any data you like, you can use Alert Manager for alerting.
Will it be possible to define dependencies between alerts? So if alert A fires, don't alert about event B?
That's essentially what inhibition does for you, right? So we have the warning alert and the critical alert, and it's essentially the same thing, just at different thresholds. And that's exactly what inhibition does for you. And you can apply this to other things as well. If you have an alert that notifies you about your cluster is down completely, you don't want to get all the pages about all your single nodes in your cluster being down. So that's what inhibition does for you.
If I remember correctly, I saw the Nagios integration on your slides.
Yeah.
How does it work, and will it work with other tools that are related to Nagios?
So Nagios is actually what we are still partially using ourselves at SoundCloud. It's basically just a simple plugin that uses the Prometheus command line interface to fire a query against the API. And you are restricted by Nagios to have a single value, so you can't make use of the dimensionality. So you have to define a Prometheus expression that boils down to one single value, and then you can, via a Nagios plugin, alert via Nagios based on Prometheus expressions.
But it's basically a Nagios plugin you use for this.
Okay. Yeah.
Thank you.
Hello. Which storage engine uses the Alert Manager? Where does the Alert Manager stores the alerts?
The initial version, this proof of concept version, did not have persistence. So the new version has persistence, and we are using basically just a SQL database.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, no more. Then
Hello. Hey. Is the standard the Alert Manager standalone program runnable, or is it just in combination with Prometheus?
No. It's a complete standalone tool. It's completely independent of Prometheus.
You probably could use it as on Nagios. So if you send notifications from Nagios to your Alert Manager, you could use the Alert Manager to configure which alerts are interesting or not?
I guess you could use it, yeah. Okay. I wouldn't take too many detours. Nagios, Alert Manager, then PagerDuty, I would reduce the number of hops, but yeah, I guess you could do that.
Okay, thanks.
What about cloud environments where I have applications with inhale and expand from 100 nodes to 5,000 nodes in 1 second to another? How do you keep up, or do you just ignore this kind and monitor from the application higher level?
I mean, generally, you have a good idea of how far you have to scale, right? You have to, of course, there are peak times you have to scale up, but you're not scaling from 100 to 5,000 for no reason. You know why, and this is happening. So of course your Prometheus server has to have the requirements to be able to scrape this data, and if you have too many instances, at some point you have to implement sharding with Prometheus.
Is there a minimum lifetime after which you take the nodes serious? And if they only live for 5 seconds, you don't care?
Retention time is configured statically with a command line flex, so yeah, usually you would have maybe 2 to 4 weeks. With more important stuff, maybe a few months. It really depends on your data. But of course, if you're getting more data than your hard drive can handle, you have to cut down retention time to basically hold it all. And at some point, you have to think about expanding into a sharded setup.
So when all your production alerts are going through one alert manager, that becomes a single point of failure. Do you have any plans to have multiple instances of that coordinate with each other?
Yeah, absolutely. So when we were thinking about let's write a new version of the alert manager that does all the things we wanted to do, of course the first thing was, okay, let's do high availability. This version is now with the initial approach to first implement all the features we want, and it's written in a way that we can hopefully make the data underneath available in an HA environment. The problem is that there are many solutions out there for CP, so for consistency, but you don't want consistency. You don't want not to be able to add new alerts if you have a net split. That's exactly the point when you want your alerts to be there. And we have not figured out the perfect solution yet. And with this new version now available, we then will eventually look how far we can get with an HA setup.
Okay, no more questions at this point, and then I think we're at the end. Thank you very much, Fabian.